thank you all very much for coming to the penultimate session of MA 2016. And I'm really, really pleased to be here. I love coming back to Glasgow because 20 years ago, I was an MA student and did a work placement here, and some people here in the room, I think I worked with. Hello. and the very short time I spent here, seeing how social action was writ large in a museum service has probably inspired me more than anything else to want to do the same in my career. So I'm very grateful to all those people that we work with, that I worked with all those years ago. But we're here today, this afternoon, to discuss the topic that's probably second only to the weather in terms of general British concerns, and that's social class. There's a quote by the man who's probably Britain's greatest living comedian, Stuart Lee, who has done a lot of work with Arts Emergency. And he said, there's never been a time when there's been less social mobility in the arts. My generation benefited from access to the arts as the generations before did. There's a real acknowledgement out there that there is a problem. So the UK government's 2016 white paper for the arts, which obviously only applied to England, put at its heart cultural participation and social mobility. But I ask you whether social mobility has been in retreat in museums. And I think this is especially the case of workforce and leadership. So do economic factors have a malign effect on creating a diverse workforce? Does the cost of housing in London and our big cities preclude only the well-off from working and living comfortably? Does a middle-class workforce mean that it lacks empathy with all our communities? And from the Taking Part survey that came out last week, we know that more people are visiting museums than ever before. Over 50% of people have visited a museum at least once in the last year. But the gap between those from low incomes and higher incomes in participation is wider than ever. And also, are the privately educated still overrepresented in roles in our major museums, in our national museums? There are more people in the cabinet that went to state schools than the directors of national museums. On the panel, I have a variety of perspectives which we're going to share today. And the panel is from across our cultural sphere, from museum directors to new entrants to academics. And so on the panel, we have Dave O'Brien. Dave is the University of Edinburgh's Chancellor's Fellow in Cultural and Creative Industries, and he's based at the History of Art Department. His books include Cultural Policy and After Urban Regeneration, and he's the co-editor of the forthcoming Routledge Companion to Global and Cultural Policy. He's also written several papers on inequality and cultural jobs, and he's written much about the use of public value theory in museums. Jess Turtle has worked in the cultural sector for 15 years, and she currently works on policy and programmes with the policy and programmes team at the MA. And she's there responsible for running the Transformers programme. She's also the chair of the homelessness charity, the Simon Community, and she co-founded the Museum of Homelessness in 2014, which she'll tell us a little bit more about later. Cindy Sughure is the director of the Charles Dickens Museum, a position that she's held for just over a year now. She's worked in the cultural sector in the UK for 26 years, including roles as diverse as the director of the Collective Gallery and the chief executive and producer of Scottish Ballet. And finally, Sana Ikram is a museum professional who graduated from the SOCL programme. Now, SOCL is the Strengthening Our Common Life by Nurturing Heritage Skills, and it's co-sponsored by Cultural Corporation. Sana was a HLS Skills for the Future trainee and based at the Museum of Zoology in Cambridge last year. She continues to play a significant role in the sector by actively engaging on Twitter and participating in conferences and being a member of Museum Detox, which I think you're going to tell us more about later, a networking group for Black, Asian and Minority Ethnic museum professionals. Ladies and gentlemen, our panel. So before we start, I'm just going to quickly ask each of you, what social class were you born into?
So I was born into the working class.
I'm what you might call mixed class. So my mum is middle class and my dad is working class.
Working class?
Working class?
Working class.
Okay. So I'm going to start with Dave. What do you think is the best way to measure class and to measure social class in our profession?
So this has been an issue that's kind of bedeviled sociologists for maybe 150 years. So I'll try and give you the sort of 2-minute version. I think it's important to separate out what we're talking about. And there's three things to talk about. One is people's sense of themselves and their identities and how it relates to social class. The objective position that people occupy in terms of their position within the labour market, and there's a couple of ways of doing that. And then there's the difference between people's origins in terms of social class and their destinations. So the way that things like the Labour Force Survey, which is the Office for National Statistics, picture of the British economy through its labour force, the way that thinks about museums and the creative sector more generally is as essentially a kind of an upper echelon or a middle class job. What this means is that although people's kind of origins in terms of class might be diverse, once they end up in the museum sector, they are broadly speaking part of the middle class. This can sometimes clash really, really heavily with their sense of identity in terms of their origins and what they brought into this middle class profession. And we've got some interview data that suggests diverse class origins can be a bit of a barrier to people once they enter this broadly speaking middle class job. But also it means that often it can be difficult to kind of objectively measure class. Because people will, you know, kind of be attached to one class position in terms of identity, but actually have a different class position in terms of their labour market position.
Okay. So you were involved in research into the performing arts back in 2015, and that summarised, the findings were summarised as art sector employment is a closed shop dominated by the middle classes. Can you describe some of the findings?
Yeah, so I tweeted one of the papers that underpins some of this research. And what we found was that, broadly speaking, there's a really big overrepresentation of those from more affluent or more middle-class social origins working in these middle-class artistic and cultural jobs. And unfortunately, this is the same for the museums, galleries, heritage sectors as well. We found really significant evidence of quite large gender pay gaps in some cultural organisations, cultural occupations, and also evidence of some class origin-based pay gaps, although we account for this largely to do with people's educational experiences. You're less likely to go to particular higher education courses and institutions if you're from a working class background, which means that you're likely to earn less once you get, or if you get into middle class cultural professions. The other thing, which I think is really important, you know, I've spent a few minutes talking about social class, but the overwhelming evidence is that class is something that's experienced in an intersectional fashion. And we should think of class intersectionally. So it's not just about your kind of social origin in terms of what your parents did for a living when you were 14 that, you know, might be an objective marker of your initial class starting point. But also this intersects with gender, with ethnicity, sexuality, disability. And unfortunately, particularly in a recent paper, we've tried to tease out the idea that the more distance individuals working in cultural jobs have from the kind of norm of being an affluent origin, middle class, white man, the more they are likely to encounter barriers and the more they are likely to struggle in cultural and creative professions. And we think this kind of intersectional analysis is really how, you know, it's a really crucial way of thinking about social class.
So were there, did you feel there were any surprises?
No, which is a bit depressing. I mean, there are sort of like some interesting stats surprises. So in the labour force survey, for example, the museum's workforce doesn't exhibit a really big gender pay gap, which is quite good, compared to, say, architecture, where the gender pay gap is absolutely monstrous. It's clear that the museum's workforce, according to the labour force survey, is very, very female in terms of gender balance. Actually, it's really, you know, women are really kind of well represented. And in terms of kind of class origins, it's as we expect. It's quite a posh job, although the social exclusions are not as bad as in publishing. But unfortunately, these kinds of exclusions for these sort of middle class or upper kind of category jobs basically mirror what you'd find in other kind of upper, you know, category jobs. So, you know, the kind of problems that, say, law, accountancy, medicine have, the kind of problems that the cultural sector has as well.
Were there any regional variations?
We've actually just finished a paper on that, and the numbers mean it's quite difficult to say anything coherent. We've actually done another project which involved just under 250 interviews with creative and cultural workers, some in museums, some in performing arts, some in tech across the country. And the crucial regional variation was the problem of London as a big driver of exclusion. So, you know, you can kind of make it in regions where essentially the cost of living is lower, but there is a big London problem as it's a kind of key driver of social inequality. You know, the kind of the gamble of London is that, you know, you can potentially win big in a cultural job if you're working in London, but, you know, your lifestyle is going to be much worse, and you're much more likely to encounter the kinds of financial oppositions, or kind of, you know, the lack of economic capital that means that class-based social exclusions are stronger.
Thank you. Great, thanks. Jess, so we know a diverse workforce is really essential to ensure that our museums reflect the lived experience of all our audiences. So lived experience, I think it's really important. So you're leading the Museum of Homelessness project, and perhaps they're one of the most marginalised members of society. So can you tell us a bit about the project and why you set it up?
Sure. So as you've said, Tony, we're making the UK's first Museum of Homelessness. My husband, Matt, and I first had the idea about 2 years ago. We're both museum professionals, but with personal links to homelessness. And in the last 2 years, we've received some investment from in what's quite a complex and ambiguous idea from forward-thinking funders, the King's Cultural Institute and the Paul Hamlin Foundation. And in that time, we've been exploring the idea with people and beginning to create the thing that is the Museum of Homelessness. Now, I think it's really important to say that we don't have a building and we don't have a collection as yet. They're always the questions that people have straight away, because what we've focused on so far is the people. And together, we'll be launching our public programme at Tate Modern and Tate Liverpool in 2017. The reason that we have set a Museum of Homelessness up, I think, is because homelessness is a continuous part of our shared culture. And when I say our, I mean everyone in the room. We're all closer to it than we think. But it's often been hidden or ignored. And we think that a national institution will offer permanence and acknowledgement to that which does exist and for the lives lived within that sort of frame. It's also a way of unpicking the complexities of homelessness, which are still not understood. Museums do that really, really well. They research and share complexity very well. So we think we can contribute in that way. And finally, and probably most importantly for us, I think, the social and cultural capital that is held by museums is incredibly rich. And the Museum of Homelessness is really a device, actually, for rerouting some of that to people who might not otherwise access it. And that's a really critical thing for us.
Great, thank you. So within your role in the MA, sort of moving on to the MA work now.
Sure.
Around the, you know, sector skills, that sort of thing. Do you think we talk enough about class in terms of diversity?
I don't think we do, and that's something that I wrote an inclusion paper for museums this year that came out of some research we did for Transformers last year. I think, and in that we called for class to be more recognised within discussions around diversity. I think it isn't. I think that's probably partially because it's not legislated for. The Equalities Act is, it's not one of the protected characteristics within the Equalities Act, but I think if that legislation and the policy that comes with it is about addressing the fact that some characteristics have historic and present day disadvantage, then class should be part of that conversation.
Great. So, how, in that, going back to the kind of lived experience idea, so how important do you think lived experiences is to people working in museums and maybe leading museums? Because I can't imagine that many museum directors will live in an area that's close to many non-visitors.
I think it's absolutely essential for museums which are dealing with identity, with issues around identity and the sort of social realm. And I think it's so important because the very best cultural products and processes, not only in museums but right across the arts, are transformational. And they're transformational when people engage with them. They have a subjective shift. They have a moment of resonance. Through that engagement, we get to know ourselves a little bit better. That's how we make meaning in the world. That, for me, is the most important thing about working in culture. And I don't think those things can be created with integrity if the people who are creating them and sharing them don't have that frame of lived experience to work within.
So how could we then improve the empathy of people working? Because, I mean, empathy is a skill that in the future people will need to amplify. It will be one of those skills that I think is that millennials will have in spades compared to previous generations. So I wonder how we might amplify empathy within our workforce.
Do you mean in terms of better inclusion?
Yeah,
I think that's probably the answer.
Okay.
Is by, you know, including people more effectively from diverse backgrounds. So it's not necessarily about positive action schemes or increasing diversity. It's also about making our workplaces more inclusive so that once people are in, it's an enjoyable and rewarding experience to work within our institutions. I don't know if any of your research has shown this, Dave, but one of the things that we've uncovered anecdotally at the Museums Association that we do want to explore more is that there's a retention issue for people who self-identify as diverse, who come into the sector, and then they might leave at mid-career point, not reach leadership level, because actually it's really tough to navigate a career in the sector, and that's one of the truths that we all need to face, I think, and think about how we're going to manage that.
Okay, great. Thank you. So I'm going to move on to Cindy now. Now, you grew up in America, in Boston, and I wonder, and we met at a very lavish dinner at the Art Fund Prize, didn't we? And we got talking about class, and it seemed very sort of incongruous that we were sitting in this fantastic gilded building with the Duchess of Cambridge presenting an award to the V&A. And we got talking about our backgrounds. And I wonder if you could describe your upbringing, how you progressed into higher education and later a career in the sector.
Absolutely. Well, I was born into a working class family in Boston, in America. And my father, particularly, was desperately poor. He'd been born in 1929, the year of the stock market crash, and grew up in a very poor Irish Scottish immigrant family. And I was born as number two in a family of four children, so there's six of us all together. And we grew up, I suppose, feeling shame about being part of the working class. My parents were desperately keen to progress us. So going back to Dave's point about, you know, your origins and your destination, they referred to us as lower middle class, an interesting phrase that's often used in America, to signal that we were to make ourselves better. My father worked incredibly hard, as did my mum. She was a queen of thrift. She could make magic out of nothing. from clothing to food. It was extraordinary. But what they did, which was absolutely pivotal, is they moved us into a community that had a really good school system. And they instilled in us the value of education and the value of really grabbing every opportunity that came our way. So that was both, the fortune and the misfortune of my childhood, because I suddenly was exposed to things that my parents never had, and they never imagined that we would have either. It was quite extraordinary. I suspect my parents worried quite deeply about how they would enable any of us kids to go into university education in a country where there was no state funding. They simply didn't have the means. And rather perversely for me, I think my next steps and my progression to higher education was facilitated one summer by my parents dying both in quick succession, and we found ourselves, four of us, orphans, and opportunity opened with a little bit more financial support than would have been the case otherwise. So through that perverse change of fortune, we got an opportunity that we simply wouldn't have done growing up in that very poor Irish-Scottish South Boston community. But the gift, really, they gave us was this sense of hard work and thrift and determination. And that uniquely has enabled me to find a really interesting career in the cultural sector, because it's not really a choice you would make from a poor background. You wouldn't choose a profession where you know the odds of getting a job are pretty slim, let alone progressing through the stages. But they gave us a sense of confidence in trying something new. So my first job in the cultural sector was here in Scotland, in fact. I came to the UK on a scholarship to do a PhD. And I realized after doing a PhD that academia wasn't really for me. It didn't feel an environment where I could make a difference. So I wanted to get involved somehow in the cultural sector. So I was applying for jobs and really knocking on very closed doors. I realized I didn't have the right degree from the right institution or the right background or connections. So the first job I took was a job that I think no one else would take. It was 1990, so the pay, it will sound remarkable, but not too bad. My full-time salary was £6,750. That was full-time. And it was working for an organization that was in transition or crisis, and that gave me my foot in the door. And I didn't worry about the fact that it didn't have money and it was going to be hard work, because I grew up without money and knowing how to work hard. And I found as each job I went into, I found myself drawn to the organization that perhaps couldn't pay very much. You could use your thriftiness, but you also were in a position to make a difference through sheer grit and hard work. So it was fascinating. Just, I never thought of it as I was going through life. But right back to my early years and my parents instilling a sense of those values and valuing education and opportunity and never missing a chance to engage in something a bit different.
Thank you. So bearing in mind you've been both sides of the Atlantic, I wonder if you... Do you notice any difference between the UK and the US to attitudes to, as you described, thrift, moderation, hard work?
Well, it's interesting. When I came to the UK in 1985, of course, it was not long after miners' strikes. I found myself first in London and then doing research in Yorkshire and very much in those mining and steelworking communities. So I found a great affinity there between what I'd known in America. But the thing that I suppose concerns me the most now is that we see a culture which has changed in the last 10, 15 years here, where education isn't universally accessible. And I think that is the biggest challenge we're facing now, and one of the main causes of the increasingly narrow opportunity for social mobility within the cultural sector. When I came here in 1985, there were loads of people doing extraordinary degrees, and they were fully funded to do so. And we're seeing that change fundamentally and becoming a system much more like America, where even though it is a classless society, you still need money and a significant amount of it to get any sort of education and to find your way a foot in the door. So...
Now, Sana, you grew up in the States as well. You lived in the States when you were younger. Could you give us a sense of your early experiences?
So I was born in America. My father worked in fast food, and my mother was a housewife. And I had an older brother as well. So the only experience I really ever had in America was just going to elementary school, really, before my parents decided to separate, and then I came to the UK. And then I was raised by a single mother then, so it was a little bit harder after that. But yeah, with the support of my dad in America, things were okay. I feel, looking back, maybe that I wouldn't have had the opportunity to get as much of an education as I did here. Just because the values are different. And yeah, I just feel like in the UK, I had a better chance in terms of education to reach university, which a lot of my family hasn't really had the opportunity. I'm one of the first, I am the first in my immediate family to graduate from university. So that was a really big achievement for me when I came to the UK.
I'm going to ask the floor the same question, actually. Yeah. Who in this room was the first generation of their family to go to university? So that's less, yeah. Just about less than half? Or half?
Yeah, I'm still quite surprised by the amount of hands that went up, to be honest.
Okay.
But yeah, that's great.
So you were a Sockle HLF Skills for the Future trainee.
Yeah.
Can you describe the program and what you, how you feel you benefited from it, but also the approach and whether you feel that it, you know, prepared you well for getting into the sector?
Yeah. So when I graduated from university, I did a degree in Egyptology, and I was at a point where I was very studious in school, but I was at a point where I didn't really want to study anymore, and I really had this passion to start working and start getting practical experience. And I wasn't quite sure how to do it. I did volunteer for a little while at the local museum, which I had a previous relationship with because I did a dissertation based on their ancient Egyptian mummy that they had there. So I built on that, started volunteering for them for a little bit, and networking actually came in place then. There was somebody that I went to college with, and they knew somebody who was on the Sokol program, so she recommended me to apply, and she applied herself as well. I didn't know that much about the program beforehand, apart from the fact that they were really driving the opportunity for diverse people from diverse backgrounds to apply. It would be a way to enter the museum sector. And I was doing my research at the time, and I was thinking, well, I don't have a master's. How do I get into museums? I have to volunteer for 2-3 years before I get a job. But this was a really good way for me to get my foot in the door. The application process was actually really competitive, but I was really happy with the way that they were recruiting and their process for that. The application form was, you didn't have to write like a big, massive personal statement.
Yeah.
They asked really direct questions to get good examples for your experience. So you were able to kind of get to the point with your experience a lot better. And the interview was actually really different as well. They had more of a like, an interviewee day where you'd meet the panelists of the interview and you'd talk with them and get to know them, and then at the end of the day you would have the formal interview. So that was a really good recruitment.
So for those of you that have recruited, it seems a very a different way than our regular recruitment in our sector, much more involved,
yeah,
much more kind of put, you know, human-centered almost.
Yeah, definitely. I was really happy with the way they did that. And what also persuaded me to apply was the fact that they added value to the experience by making sure that you get qualified for a vocational qualification in cultural heritage after that as well. So I thought, you know, instead of going that academic route and doing a master's further into Egyptology, it kind of gave me a broader skill set and a broader perspective into the museum world. So as not to be too specialized and too curatorial, I was able to go into different aspects of work, such as, you know, community engagement and outreach. Okay. And I also built on my digital skills as well.
Okay, fantastic. So you've done your course.
Yeah.
you've done your traineeship. What do you find most frustrating about trying to get into the profession now, to get that first job?
Yeah, well, I thought the traineeship would be my foot in the door and that it would lead then smoothly onto something else. But unfortunately, that wasn't the case. I'm still struggling to apply for jobs now, and it's more than a year later. I think for me, a lot of the challenges that I faced when applying for jobs is making your application stand out first. And I spend so much time writing personal statements for applications. And I follow all the guidelines, all the advice on making sure that your examples hit the criteria that they ask for in the specification. I just don't know. And then at the end, when I do get an interview, probably once or twice in the past year, I've had an interview for a museum job specifically. And then I'd have challenges competing against internal applicants, as well as I've been also trying to network. So there's been jobs where I know museum professionals who Sure. work in the same museum, who have connections to people who they might be able to introduce me to talk about the post, and then that still kind of falls through at the end of the day.
So it's incredibly frustrating, but I would say you are very well connected and you are very active on Twitter. And
Thank you.
Many people here probably know who you are. But I think that we know it's frustrating, and we know that since 2010, the numbers of, ways into the sector, the numbers of jobs are much less than they were. So it is tough out there. Keep going.
Yeah.
Get something in the air. But so we've kind of heard quite a broad spectrum here from the idea of how we identify class, how we self-identify class. We know the profession is by its nature a middle class profession, but there are still gaps there. There are still gaps to within our organisations to show a kind of level of empathy or lived experience to many of the people who come to our museums. And tomorrow, I think when we have the Brexit debate, I'm sure some of those themes will come out there. So I'd like to throw it open to the floor. We've got half an hour left of the session. So I'd like to throw it open to you to ask our panel a little bit more about what they've said, or ask something completely off the wall. It would be quite nice towards the end of the session if we could try and ask the questions, what could be done? How could our profession address the gap? But in the meantime, please put your hands up and ask away. We've got some roving mics. Right, up there. First off, I'm going to put my glass on to see you. Is that Sharon?
Yes, it is.
It is Sharon.
Hi, Sharon. Hi, Sharon. Maybe the question we should ask is about recruitment and how we recruit into the sector, because the question you asked the audience was which one of us was the first in our family to get a degree, and maybe the question should be who's not got a degree here? I've not got a degree.
Oh, yeah?
So maybe we should look at what the bar is in terms of recruitment. At the Museums Association, we ask for GCSEs minimum. That's it. We don't ask for degrees for any job, including my job when I applied for it. So maybe we should, which is a good job, obviously I wouldn't have got it. But maybe we should think about how we recruit into the sector.
Absolutely.
Definitely, I agree with Sharon there.
Can I?
Yeah,
I agree with, unsurprisingly, I agree with Sharon on that one. I think it's absolute madness the level to which the sector is over-professionalised. And the way in which some roles are held within the academic realm is unnecessary. I think in Dave's research, it showed that 76% of the museum workforce have an undergraduate degree or higher. The only one that was higher than that was architecture out of all of the creative industries. And I just think, why? It's unnecessary. So at the Museum of Homelessness, we haven't been going long, but we've already proven that it's absolutely possible for people with limited literacy skills to perform a curatorial function really, really effectively. It's about being creative with the processes that we have by sharing generously and not being precious about our practice. So I would absolutely agree with that.
I mean, this is something that's happened across lots of different jobs in British society, but it's particularly noticeable in creative jobs as they've become credentialised. Mm. So the kind of classic example of this is something like journalism, which was essentially a kind of trade that, you know, was run by a series of apprenticeships, and now it's very much a kind of master's degree from specific, mainly London, institutions that kind of gets you in to this sector. And I think it's interesting to observe how there's an unfortunate kind of confluence of the long boom in education and art sector jobs that went together that, you know, has begun to come to an end, I think, that allowed for some really positive things to happen in terms of people reflecting on their practice and their academic skills. And now maybe we need to kind of ask precisely the questions you're asking about what's the cost of this been, and in a shrinking labour market, how can we kind of keep routes open that don't involve a master's degree? Mm.
Maria, then Matt. And it's incidental music to fill the space. Take heart.
Thank you. It's Maria Balshaw from the Whitworth, which is a university art gallery, and the Manchester Art Gallery, which is the city's art gallery. And I want to follow on from Sharon to say, all of us in the room, what on earth is stopping us changing these things? Yeah, exactly. Because I would say at the Whitworth, we are a university art gallery, and none of the posts at any level are academic posts. They're all academic related. Some require a degree, not very many of them, but certainly all of our below grade six posts are open to any relevantly qualified candidate, because the areas where we're not doing well are around engaging people who don't have degrees and don't habitually come to art galleries. So why on earth would I want only people who habitually go to art galleries and are already middle class? It's bonkers. We super serve those audiences. And in changing our recruitment, in changing what is put on our website, and as you've talked about, changing the ways that we recruit people. Yeah. So we use the kinds of recruitment that you see in the commercial sector, where they want a really broad demographic of people working in their organisations. We almost overnight were able to create a front-facing team that look a bit like our city. And that's what will make the people of our city come in. And I just think we are not tough enough on ourselves, because university HR department could not have been more delighted to help us, because the university wants to diversify its workforce as well.
Yeah, definitely. Thanks for that comment, and I can definitely relate to that. There are many jobs that I applied for that have more of a kind of practical approach to the work. Lots of exhibition assistant jobs where they require a master's or a PhD in the subject that they're working with, the collection that they're working with, when really they just need somebody who can be handy with tools and make mounts and place objects in their cases, really. So I've definitely encountered that, where I feel that I'm relatively qualified for the job, but maybe I don't know as much about the collection, but I'll be able to know how to handle them well and maintain the collection.
I would agree with Maria. I think the time is right, and I think it is changing, because I've noticed an incredible permeability in the museum sector, which I've only worked in for over a year now, but I've worked in visual art, music, dance, theatre, festivals. I've worked across the cultural sector. And I came into museums thinking that it would have a higher level of impenetrableness to someone like me who's come from a different part of the cultural sector. But no, I've been incredibly impressed at how open people are and institutions are, and we're perhaps not sharing that enough publicly, because I think a lot of us are doing it and we're recruiting in to enable us to have not only a better, more diverse workforce, but one that really speaks to our existing and potential audiences.
So I just wanted to add one more thing to that. I think thinking about recruitment processes and lived experience, I think as museums move into more socially engaged practice, we might do well to learn from the third sector, where quite often lived experience is privileged as part of the recruitment process. So just on Saturday, I was talking to someone who has a conviction for fraud and theft, and he's actually built his career, he's in recovery now from a gambling addiction, and he's built a new career out of that, supporting other people who are going through similar crises. So perhaps if the museum sector is becoming more socially engaged, that's something that we can think about. How do you actually privilege and respect that type of lived experience and incorporate it into the recruitment processes?
And just very quickly, unconscious bias training. The cultural sector and museums and galleries as part of that are at an unfortunate kind of juncture between a set of very open, very liberal political, cultural, social views that in some ways mean that the sector is often not as reflexive as it needs to be, because there is the assumption that, but we're the good guys. Mm. You know, we're not like, say, you know, law or accountancy or medicine, which, you know, often don't share the same liberal, open, tolerant, meritocratic views, but have similar kind of patterns of exclusion. There's a really good phrase from some American work on advertising called hiring as cultural matching. The idea that when hires are made, often it's the kind of soft skills, these sorts of often unsaid things about cultural similarity that lead to hiring, that, you know, kind of get narrated as talent or appropriateness for the job or whatever. And this phenomenon, I think, is crucial for the museum sector to reflect on and to think about its own unconscious biases that lead to the workforce essentially kind of replicating itself.
Thanks.
Thanks, Tony. It's interesting because I don't know if I'm as optimistic about some of the practice. I used to work in the British Museum years ago, and I sort of came up, you know, I made the transition from sort of the shop floor and practical support work into management at the British Museum, which at that time in the 80s was quite progressive in a sort of paternalistic way at sort of supporting people who didn't have academic qualifications, in some cases didn't have, you know, even, you know, GCSE qualifications, and there was a lot of support within the structures. And it strikes me that there's a slightly distorted lens that we seem to have when we talk about museum employment. And there's a lot of working class people that work in museums, but they work in support services, they work in kitchens, they work as security guards and so on. And I don't think we look hard enough at our own processes within organisations. We talk about people coming into the sector and we know how hard that is, and we need to make it much more inclusive and accessible and so on. But I think we've got to be much more critical about how we imagine what museum work is, and in our sort of imaginary of what professional museum work is, because I think every, you know, people who slave from 7 o'clock in the morning, you know, making sure all museums are clean, ready to, yeah, exactly, to take all the crap that gets thrown at them by, you know, visitors day in and day out, you know, a critical parts of our employment are as much as professional as anybody else. There's very few of them in this room. There's very few of them who can get sent to conferences. But I think we need to be very, very critical of our own internal dynamics, really, when we're talking about this.
Great point. Yeah, really, really good point. Down here. Oh, thanks, Nat. That's really very prescient.
Hi, Ashley Taylor from Blaenavon World Heritage Site. I just want to pick up on some of the points around the kind of the lived experience and the professions that we have. I think sometimes as a sector, we safeguard ourselves because we're all highly qualified, lots of experience. And so we recruit in-house because actually we've all worked really hard for it. But actually that means at the end that we're not that relevant because we're relevant to ourselves. And so we put our own organisation, our own sector first rather than the community. And we do it without even realising. Yeah. I'm working at the moment with a model with youth engagement, and what we've done is we've gone out and we've recruited totally out of sector, completely. In fact, we didn't require any heritage knowledge at all. And I can tell you the person that came on board had no heritage knowledge, but he was a professional youth worker with the professional skills, with the lived experience, with lots of knowledge. And he's brought that into the sector, and we're now an award-winning programme because we didn't safeguard the heritage first. We put the people first. Mm. We put our community first. We put our young people first. So I think there's that balance to be had. We've all worked really hard. I don't want to be out of a job, and I'm sure nobody else does. You know, we have worked hard, but I think as a sector, we need to really look outside. And I think your point, Jess, about bringing in third sector is absolutely crucial if we want to be relevant, because quite often it's the third sector that's out there working as charities with the people we want to engage with. Well, if they're working with those people directly, let's bring them into our sector so we work with them directly, rather than assuming that we can all be everything. You know, we can be learning officers, we can be teachers, we can be social workers, we can be health professionals, we can be prescribers of health medicines, you know, because we're all about well-being. Actually, let's bring other people in, which will actually diversify our workforce anyway.
Yeah. Great, that's really powerful.
Ashley, you used to work at the Agency, right?
I know, I'm really, really proud of you. Really proud of
Thank
you.
Thank you so much.
I was the volunteer manager.
She was my first volunteer manager when I volunteered at the Egypt Center when I was doing my degree. So that was the first museum work I actually got. So that's a great throwback.
Laura, thank you.
Thanks. Hi, I'm Laura Pye from Bristol. I think we also have to acknowledge that we've created a bit of a vicious circle in this whole process, because I would class myself as coming from a working class background, and I will fully accept that I am every part middle class now. Yeah. But I spent the first 10 years of my career with my parents on my case about the fact that they had worked bloody hard for me to go to university, and I was in a very low paid job in museums. And that kind of, you know, I spent 10 years with them telling me that with a master's degree, I could be earning three times as much in the Inland Revenue, which is lovely if you want to work in the Inland Revenue.
My
but
dad worked
in as it. I didn't. That was, but I think we've created that vicious circle so that people that do see education and have put lots of time and effort into that, because we do say it needs a degree to do those jobs, those working class people that have fought for that and got to that point, then suddenly turn around and go, well, actually, having worked this hard and to pay off my student loan, I'm not sure I want to earn what you earn in museums. And so we've created a kind of vicious circle for that that is also a problem for me, I think.
Okay. Thanks. Hazel. It's down here.
Thank you. Hazel Edwards, also from Bristol. I want to change the subject from class to gender, is that okay?
Fine, yeah, whatever.
Yeah. So given that I think we all in this room accept that museums and their staff should reflect lived experience, I'm wondering what the panel think about the feminisation of the workforce and whether that's of concern going forward. And also a question for Dave, is there a connection between the feminisation of museum workforce and class?
So one of the interesting debates that's going on generally about creative work at the moment is the intersection of gender and class and pay, and the extent to which creative work, as it's opened up to women, and as creative work has become less kind of male-dominated, again, you know, journalism, but also things like museums, whether that has been bound up with increasing insecurity, lower rates of pay, that kind of stuff. I think it's really important to celebrate the museum sector in particular because of its gender imbalance, actually. According to the Labour Force survey, at least, there are many more women in the sector than compared to, say, the IT sector, which is very dominated by men, or architecture, which is very dominated by men. The issue, I suppose, becomes one of change over time. Are we seeing the feminization of the workforce is something that is essentially women's long march through the institutions to take over the museum sector, because, you know, much of this change we think has happened because of the expansion of HE, particularly at master's level in the early 90s, and now women are coming up to leadership roles. But in our fieldwork interviews, we've run into really, you know, appalling stories of institutionalized sexism, particularly around the decision to have children, and the real lack of ability of particularly formal institutions to switch their demands for, you know, 7 days a week working. Can you just come in on the Tuesday night because we launch tomorrow, or we can only have that meeting on Friday morning, to actually, you know, my kids go to nursery on these dates, I can't come in on that, I can't just drop everything, this kind of thing. And that seems to be a crucial point for women to, if you were being kind of polite about it, you know, kind of diversify their employment and start to, you know, look for consultancy work, etc. But actually, if you're being blunt about it, that, you know, the sexist barriers they run into means they don't get promoted to senior levels because they leave the profession, particularly, as I say, around that kind of decision to have children. We've not written this up yet because we're just kind of getting the data back, but that seems to be, you know, something that on the one hand we should be celebrating because the workforce is changing, but also on the other hand it probably is something that accounts for the disconnect between a very female workforce and a very, very male senior decision-making cohort.
Mm. Mm. So are we saying, Dave, in your data, that, because that is my assumption, but I haven't seen the data, that although that it's a strongly female workforce, the positions at the top, the power positions, are predominantly male?
Yeah, and the question is will this kind of get better naturally through effectively kind of attrition, when senior men are retiring, or is it the case that, you know, I said sectors kind of hire people who are like them, they have assumptions about, well, you know, how do you be a leader, you know, this kind of stuff, which is very, very gendered and very framed in kind of gendered language and gendered assumptions. I don't know, we'll have to see, but these are again the kind of moments where particularly in the bigger formal institutions, you can say, look, this actually needs work, it needs addressing, you know, and the moments for change need to be kind of seized as well.
Mm. Going back to Hazel's question, which was about what we think about the feminization, it's fascinating because I say I enjoy working in a workplace where there's a mix of people, whether it's gender, whether it's background, whether it's political views. It just makes more a more interesting place of work. I don't know what the solution is, but it concerns me only insofar as we could become a sector that doesn't necessarily empathise with the wider population that we're serving.
Can I just ask David about the question about governance? Because obviously when we get to the kind of leadership level, or even just below that, appointments are made by governing bodies. So has your research taken into account the makeup or the nature of governing bodies?
Not yet.
Okay.
But we'd kind of like to.
Give me a bit more than that.
Yeah.
Okay. Does anyone have any experience of coming up against governing bodies or working with governing bodies to, extend the kind of the pool of people in leadership roles?
Hi there, Oliver Cox, University of Oxford, which in itself I think is sort of slightly problematic in this room. And I suppose given the sound of my voice as well, I'm really, really interested in how people like me, white, male class, upper middle class, what's our role in this? Because clearly we've got a role, those of the new generation coming through here who, yeah, have my background, but what would they, in the panel's experience, what helps? Because I'm sitting here feeling like crap and trying to think, what's my role? What do I do? Because clearly I have those soft skills. I have those things that are highlighted as a real challenge for people in the sector. So there's got to be an advocacy role that comes from the sort of, you know, your standard museum people, hasn't there? And I'd be really, really interested in what the panel thinks the sort of way forward is there. Thanks. Right, that wasn't really an answer either.
That's a question.
Well, I would say, firstly, don't apologise for who you are or what your background is. I think that this discussion is about, perhaps, you know, going back to the working class thing, is that most people who've come from a working class background have felt they've had to apologise along the way or hide it. You know, the number of people I speak to who, you know, they're progressing from their class of origin through to their class now, the lady there talking about, you know, we're now middle class because we've progressed through. It doesn't change who you are. So you should, please don't apologise for who you are and what you do. You bring a valuable perspective to the community. So don't underestimate yourself.
I mean, in terms of our research, this is the question that I find most fascinating, because as a essentially, you know, a political project for change, there is a question about how you present the data. Mm-hmm. How do you kind of, you know, enroll senior male decision makers in projects for change without kind of immediately addressing them as a problem? Because actually, they're not a problem. They are the solution, because at the moment, they're in positions of power. And this is why, you know, I go back to mentioning stuff like unconscious bias training. Again, thinking of some of the fieldwork interviews we've done, we interviewed a publisher who talked in quite a lot of detail about kind of sexism in publishing industry, but then he talked about how he got his current job to head a team of women. And it was just a bit like, if only you could be self-aware at that moment, you know. So yeah, I think presenting kind of like the senior white man as a problem has limitations. It's important to kind of flag up these inequalities, but also it has to be done in a way that brings them in to change the sector.
I would agree with that, David. I think the key in what you've just said is self-awareness. I think all of us, in whatever our role is, we've all got some influence. We can all make some small changes happen. Whether it's in choosing how we're going to recruit people, trying to recognise micro iniquities, which are part of unconscious bias, which I think everyone probably displays at some point or another. So developing that self-awareness and taking responsibility, thinking through those things. So yeah, out of the diversity research that the MA did last year, one of our recommendations was that unconscious bias is properly looked at in the sector. As part of organisational development and as part of people's professional development as well. And I think that would make a big difference.
Great. Question there and question there.
Oh, sorry. Hi, Karen Wright. I'm the policy manager at the Art Fund.
Yeah, it's not... I can't.
Sorry?
It's not working.
Hello?
Oh, that's
Oh, here we go.
That's better.
I'm Karen Wright. I'm the policy manager at the Art Fund. I want to discuss another element of education beyond degrees. Arts education in schools in England is being threatened by UK government policies, which will make it even harder for diverse young people to enter our sector. How can we work to ensure that arts is integrated with the wider curriculum in schools to ensure that the arts sector is both a visible and a realistic option for young people?
Who wants to start?
Well, I think that's a pretty big question. But this, interestingly, came up in the Activist Museum session that I was in earlier this morning, where the group decided to campaign to make sure that school children across Scotland were given the ability to go on school trips to museums and art galleries, because I believe there's some disparity at the moment between counties as to who some people have to self-select. If they can't afford to go on the bus, they can't go on those trips. So I think a lot of it will be around looking at social policy, making sure that access is there. If people aren't able to come into the museums, then figuring out how to go out and be visible within the communities and going to them.
Anybody else? I mean, one of the things I think we've probably all experienced is that certain classes of society have capabilities to get involved more than others. So, I mean, there's been a number of occasions when in organisations I've worked and we've put free educational activities on or free family learning activities, and you can guarantee that middle-class parents book their kids on as soon as they become available. And so perhaps something that's affirmative on our part, perhaps advertising in selective areas,
looking at developing programs that are absolutely geared towards a geographical community within your city. So there's that sort of thing to guard against, as well as that general need, I think, to champion the arts in education.
But I'm conscious of the audience I'm talking in front of, but that's also a question about the institutions changing themselves as well. And so, you know, we know the audience data, we know who doesn't go to museums, and, you know, the question that confronts us all, I think, as people who care about this, is this a matter of kind of, you know, implanting the desire to go to the museum in young people and hoping they come through, or is it about thinking what it is that museums do that aren't attracting people, that aren't getting people in, and how they might change their practices? And I think, you know, the workforce is one of those, and going beyond how you advertise, etc., is important too.
I've just had the headshot. Sorry, Yasmin. So anyway, thank you very much for coming. I think that we've covered quite a lot there. But to sum up, I think there are a number of things we need to consider. You know, it starts with us. We can make the change. People in our organisations can make the change and think much more clearly about how we build our organisations together. The point around unconscious bias, I think, is a really important one, and one that perhaps we need to be much more mindful of. Can I just finish quickly? We're just asking Cindy one question.
Of course.
What would Charles Dickens make of the debates about social mobility today? Oh,
I think he'd be slightly bemused that 200 years later we were still talking about social class. However, he wouldn't sit on his hands. He was first and foremost a fearsome social reformer and campaigner. Yes, he was a great novelist, but he also made speeches. He would have been blogging, tweeting. He would have been leading the campaign from the front and weaving these issues into his latest fiction.
Great, thank you. And on that note, thank you very much for coming, and thank you to our panel.